Here I am, nearly 15 years ago, the fall of 1998, in South Sudan, in the middle of the bush, standing over a body of a small child that from the waist down was gone from a landmine. I knew I had to do something. I'm devastated inside. I didn't know what I was going to do. I knew I had to do something. And I stood over that body and I said, God, I'll do whatever it takes to help these people. I get a lot of people, they say, well, Sam, why does it seem like you're always in conflict areas? And I think a lot of it goes back to my childhood. I started smoking dope at 11 years old. 13 years old, I was doing acid and hard drugs. 15 years old, I'm putting a needle in my arm, shooting up cocaine and heroin. Kept going deeper, I went into selling drugs, and I'm not talking about small amounts. I'm talking large amounts of drugs, and it kept going deeper until I became the shotgunner, a hired gun for drug deals. And then finally, I was in a really bad bar fight, Orlando, Florida, and it turned out to be a shootout. And I almost lost my life that night, but you know, something happened that night. I knew somebody was gonna kill me, and see, I don't have a problem with dying, but I got a problem with what I'm gonna die for. And I knew if I kept on living the life I was gonna die for some stupid reason. Well, on the way home that night, I said, God, I'm done living this life. 2 years later, I walked into a church, lifted my hands up and said, God, here I am. You know, the thing that I tell everyone is, even as a pastor now, I'll say sometimes, who here tonight wants to give your heart to Christ? You know, where you're sitting at right now, I want you to realize God don't want your heart. God don't want your heart. It's the first thing that He pulls out of you and He throws away, and He puts an all new heart in here. But what He wants is your feet, your legs, your arms, your hands, and most of all, He wants your past. Because see, your past and your entire body, your entire soul, your entire person, who you are, is what He can use to further build the kingdom of God. You might say, I don't quite understand. Listen, I was a rough guy, so now I can deal with rough people. God only took the heart out and put a new one in. One of the very first trips I went on was a 5-week mission trip. And I went into South Sudan to put roofs on a building for a guy. The guy was building these buildings. It was like a college. And while I was in there on the very first trip, we happened to went out into the villages where there was landmines. And all of a sudden that day, inside of this one village, we seen a body of a small child that stepped on one. It devastated me so much in my heart, I knew there was something I had to do. I didn't know what. I didn't have a plan at the time. I didn't have a budget at the time. I just knew there was something I could do. But I went back home to the States and I couldn't sleep. I couldn't hardly eat. All I could see in my memory was children that were starving. I started selling my camper. I had a fishing boat like a bass tracker. I started selling everything because nothing meant anything to me anymore. How could I have these things to go out and have fun? And there's literally people dying. 3 months later, I'm back in Africa. We started going into these areas that was heavy conflict areas, bringing in medicine, bringing in doctors. I mean, people that were from gunshot to broken legs, broken arms, down to worming people. I'd find areas that the children were literally going hungry, civilians were going hungry. I'd bring truckloads of food in. And every bit of money we could bring in, we would use to rescue people. I remember one day we were working the mobile clinic, we're driving through the bush. I mean, we're right in the middle of a hot area where there's all kinds of fighting going on. And God says to me, stop. You know, instantly I thought we were stopping in a war area in order to rescue some children. So I jumped out of the vehicle, I grabbed my AK, I cocked it, I started walking around. But as we were walking around, God said to me, this is where I want the children's village. I remember arguing with God. I says, God, do you know where we're at? God, we're in the middle of a war zone. There is no way we can build a children's village out here. It's not gonna happen. God says, this is where I want the Children's Village. And now, you know, this is what I tell people all the time. If God speaks to you to do something, and you know without a shadow of a doubt that it was His voice, don't give up. The orphanage that is there right now is one of the largest working orphanages in Sudan. You know, it's just one of them. But at the same time, it would have never been there if I would have gave up. Get an attitude, whatever it takes, I'll do. And watch at the miracles that will begin to happen in your life. It was a number of years ago on the Kitgum Road inside of northern Uganda. There was a young boy and his family that was on their way from their home into the market. Well, anyways, they had an old pickup truck, and the entire family was in that old truck and all the things they were going to sell at the market that day. Well, Joseph Kony and his band of bandits ambushed them on the road that day. This is the man that cuts the lips off of children, the ears off of children. But the big thing that he does to a lot of these children is he turns them into child soldiers. As they started killing the family that was in this vehicle, they killed the mother and they killed the father almost instantly. One little girl that was about 13 years old, the soldiers began to rape her. Then they started cutting brush. They started cutting brush down and throw the brush on top of her on the road and put kerosene on her. And they burnt this child alive in front of her younger brother, which was 5 years old, and her older sister, which was probably about 16, 17 years old at the time. Finally, the one sister seen that it was coming time for them to be next. She grabbed little Walter and she started running down the road. The soldiers began to shoot at her. As they were firing their AKs, one bullet struck Angela through the neck, came out of the neck and hit Walter in the face. Knocked them both to the ground instantly, knocked them out unconscious. And just a little while after that, some men that were working for us at the time came upon all of this, chased the Lord Resistant Army away. And when they noticed, when they started picking up the bodies, they noticed the two that were laying there, Walter and Angela, was not dead. They were very much alive. They rushed them into a nearby hospital, but Walter and Angela lives to this day. You know, I brought him to the U.S., and when we were here in the U.S., they were doing surgery to his face and everything. And one day we were on our way from the doctors, and Walter said, "Father, am I going to look the same?" And I said, "Yeah, Walter, you'll look the same." His face was all bandaged up. I said, "But it'll take time, but I'm sure you're going to look good." And he said, "Well, Father, I want people to always remember I was shot." And it kind of moved on me. And I said, "What do you mean, Walter?" And he said, "Because I don't want people to ever forget what Joseph Kony and the Lord Resistant Army has done. Not just to me, but to all the other people out there." You know, I remember one time I was in this church preaching, and I was preaching up a storm that night, and a man come up to me as I was leaving, and he said to me, "Do you really think you're making a difference?" And I looked at him kind of funny, and he said, "Do you really think you're making a difference? You're sacrificing your family, you're sacrificing your wife. Are you really making a difference?" I went home that evening. I had to drive about 8 hours, and I actually started thinking, "Wow, maybe this guy is true. Am I really making a difference, God?" Well, I went back to Sudan, Africa, and I was in this one village, and this lady come running up to me, and she couldn't speak very much English, so I had to have somebody help to interpret. But she asked me, she said, "Pastor, do you remember me?" And I said, "No." And she says, "I'm the lady that you and your soldiers came into the village when they were cutting my breast off, and you rescued me." And instantly when she said that, God spoke to me and He said, "One man and one woman can make a difference, but you got to be willing to step out." I have a lot of people, they'll say to me, "Sam, what happened the last few years? How did you get to where you are now? A motion picture came out, you're in Hollywood." You know, it all comes through being faithful, but where God opened up the door was in 2005. I was featured on Dateline NBC. When I was featured that night on Dateline NBC, I sat at home watching it on my couch, and it showed me walking down a road, had a machine gun over my shoulder, and I started crying with my wife sitting on the couch, and I said, no one will ever call me again to preach. I went from preaching in churches of 50 or 100 to preaching in churches from 1,000 to 5,000 overnight. And then God just kept opening up more doors. People wanted me to write a book. People wanted me to do a movie, a documentary. Right now, we have 3 projects in Ethiopia. We have 3 projects in Uganda. We have the orphanage in South Sudan. We're getting ready to do some work in Somalia. This whole thing keeps growing and growing. So listen, what I'm trying to tell you is when you are steadfast to your call, God will keep growing that ministry. See, I don't put no limitations on what I'll do for God. God calls me to Africa, I'm going to Africa. God calls me anywhere around the world, I'm gonna go. And you wanna know something? God won't put no limitations on what He'll do for you. What I do is I rescue children. Whether I'm in a war or where I'm at, I rescue children. I might be the most messed up preacher you'll ever meet, but I love Jesus Christ, and I know that He lives today, and I know that He was crucified for us, but God rose Him, and He lives today, and He lives there for each and every one of us. I'm Sam Childers, the machine gun preacher. Everything you have just heard was the truth. Now I dare you to live it.